I begin with a mind-tickling humorous story, The Man Who Knew Too Much by Alexander Baron, where we will get to see how the knowledge became the reason for one's failure. Very unusual, isn't it? So let's see how is it. Yet he remained undeterrent in his spirit. This is what the story is all about. Before that, we start with the story. Let's do something with the author of the story, that is Alexander Baron. Now, Alexander Baron is a British author and a very contemporary name. He's a British author. And it's a contemporary name. It's not a very, I'm sure many of us have not read many stories of Alexander Baron. Anyway, and he was born in 1917 and passed away in 1919. So we can easily see how he was, when we were students, he was writing those days. So he's a very contemporary author. His best known for claimed entitled some books are From the City, From the Plough, and another London-based novel, The Low Life. Baron had an army background. He basically had worked with British Army during the World War II. He had attended Hackenley Down School. Baron served in a pioneer corps of the British Army during World War II. So he used his army experience in his writing or in his write-ups also. We get to see that also. We'll get to see when we're doing the story that he has a setup of the army background. His wartime experiences on the basis for his three best-selling novels. And that is how they gained so much of popularity. In this particular story, we will get to see how army setup and how the protocol. You know, army is one sect of the unit of any country, any society that maintain a, you can say, the highest of protocol. There's a hierarchy and they maintain that. It is a rule, by set by rules, and no democratic order of setup is required in army. So this is what definitely he had learned, and accordingly he has placed those experience in his write-ups as well. And how rules and regulations of army we have to comply. The one who joins army has to know there is no rule other than the army rule. This is a way. If not following with them, that leads to serious consequences. That also we'll get to know. After the war, he became the assistant director of the Tribune, a very prestigious magazine, a journal, Tribune. He had a special flavor of humor, fun and humor in his writings. So these are basic things of Alexander Baron. So we get to see what all important points that we came to know about this author, Alexander Baron. All in a whole, we came to know many four important points of this author, and to denote that we use square in Avdhan. First and foremost, about the author, what do we come to know? He was, as I just now had written, British and contemporary author. Contemporary means now, it's present. Secondly, he served in British Army. This is one another very important information. Usually it is rare to see army people writing books that tell a humorous story. They usually don't have this flavor of life. So staunch they become. And he served them during World War II. He must have seen all the atrocities of World War. Okay? And then comes a special fragrance, or we can say flavor, in his story, that is fun and humor. He also has included his war time experiences in his novels. So these are basic things about the author. Okay, now we move on to the story. The story begins in an army setup. We have to understand that. Army setup, what type of things that we see? Like soldiers getting training, rigorous trainings are going on, and that is the way that army setup, the story begins like. Where the soldiers, when the training get, see, it is the stories of British setup. So naturally, the army that we get to see in Indian context will not be similar. In army, in India, we call, what do we call the soldiers who get the trainings? We call them cadets. But in those, in that area, they are known as privates. Very unusual, privates. And privates means the soldiers who did not yet or who have not yet got the designations. They are not yet given the portfolios or positions or the designations. They are called privates. In India, the army, they are called as cadets. They get when they undergo the training. Okay, so they are always under the officers. Now, it is a story of a private. Private means a cadet kind of a thing. His name was Quelch. Q-U-E-L-C-H. Quelch. Private Quelch in a training depot. That is how the story begins. An army setup where the, they are getting the training. Now, in that, Private Quelch, he was special about something. The other privates, when they had come to the training, they found something with this private in particular, Private Quelch. He was nicknamed, he was given a name, very common in the hostels and the camps and all. He was nicknamed Professor. Why Professor? What has a private got to do with a professor? Because his physical appearance as well as behavior, both had a very peculiar similarity, what we can see in a professor. That is how. This is how the story begins. Okay? Now, he was a lanky, stooping, tall, horn-rimmed spectacles, a very sharp kind of spectacles he used to wear, and he used to walk like this, very sincere and serious face of sort of thing. And that was not the end. Along with that, he had a terrific habit of exhibiting his knowledge. He was a knowledgeable guy, no doubt. But then he had a terrific way of exhibiting his knowledge. Okay? So this is how the story begins. The setup is army camp. In a camp, what do you see? The tents, soldiers marching and all. A very tough life. Okay. This setup army was for the training of the privates. Now this story is about Private Quelch. The whole story, he is the protagonist of the story. He is known as to be the main character, we can say. So Private Quelch, okay? Now, he was given a nickname. What was his nickname? Just now I had told. He was named Professor. The reason behind it. What could be the reason behind it? His looks. That was lanky. Lanky means tall and bent, little stooped. That is called lanky. Stooping and wearing spectacles. And his behavior also. Whom do we call a professor? We know Professor is a man who can keep on lecturing for hours. That is what the attribute of a professor. Even we teachers also fall in the same category. But then professors are universally known for giving a droning lecture. So he had that tendency. What was it like? Lecturing and exhibiting knowledge. Now this is what we will get to see how he was it. So this is a kind of a man, he was there, okay. Now, when he initially came in that camp, he definitely won some admiration. The reason was very clear. Why? Because he really knew lot much about the subject. Anything that you could, he could speak non-stop on a particular topic. And of course, it was not that he was talking on nonsense. He really had some sense, he had depth, he had knowledge. But the only trouble was that he never knew when to stop and where to speak and what to speak. Okay? So this was his problem with that. So naturally with his knowledge, because of his knowledge, he definitely got admiration from his fellow mates. Now, admiration, they naturally came to know that this man had seen. I mean, he did something. We will get to see how what all things he had done. Like, there was a training going on. Now, a sergeant who was giving some lectures or something, or some training, he would raise his hand and just stand up and say, "Sir, actually, this was wrong. This is the correct way to do it." There's an example. The muzzle velocity or speed at which the bullet leaves the rifle, he told us, is well over 2,000 feet per second. Now, the sergeant was giving the training to the privates about the rifle that they were going to use in practical life. A voice interrupted, 2,440 feet per second. That was a professor. So you see, he was thoroughly and meticulously had done. He really had read it. But only trouble is we need to know when to speak and what to speak. The sergeant had told it was well over 2,000 feet per second. This was the speed. So he interrupted and said, it is 2,440 feet per second. Okay, so he was absolutely correct in his statement. So the sergeant was also a little annoyed in that. But anyway, that was going on. And that was not the end. On and on with his friends, whether there were some friends there sitting there, they're talking, he would come and start exhibiting his knowledge. So naturally, they started calling him, teasing him, and just started calling him the professor. His knowledge, he was so very fond of showing his knowledge, especially before his seniors. They all got to know what was the reason. You know, there are so many people, varieties of people in this world, when they keep on showing the knowledge, there is a reason to gain attention that he got. Initially, he really got a lot of admiration from his friends. Now, there was a terrific fondness. We can say fondness of showing up his knowledge. This was his perfect attribute. Okay? Now see, what had happened? He would interrupt anyone, anywhere, and go on explaining and plugging the ways wherever was required. Wherever little bit of loopholes he would get, he would just come and plug the way. This is a kind of an idiomatic expression we say. Plug the hole means like just to fill the blanks. If somebody was doing, he's there to fill it up. Like that. Now, initially when the admiration was there, but slowly what happened, people started avoiding him. It is always like that. If you keep on, you know, interrupting and correcting your fellow classmates, nobody will like you. So slowly it had happened. The privates who initially had a lot of admiration started slowly shedding their way, and they never wanted to fall in his vicinity also. Now, if there were some such certain places, when army training is very rigorous one, they were running and all, they were miles, 10 miles, 20 miles of running, and they got back. And when they had come back and was just about to rest, he would just come singing a tune and say, "How about a song, chaps?" This is there, in the book it is written. "But how about a song, chaps?" See, that particular moment when everything, everybody after has toiled too much and come and just wanted to rest, he showing an extra energy, it was nothing but to show up his knowledge. He deliberately was doing that because his intention was very clear. His intention got to know, people got to know his intention. That was to get a commission. Commission here has a different meaning, children. It has got nothing to do with the commission that we say with the business deal. This commission means to get a position in the army sooner. In the army air life of India, its commissioning is the deputy. They get ultimately they get a post. In India, they got it second lieutenant. Second lieutenant they are, and finally they got the first rank, that is called captain. So he was going to get that commission. Everybody was aspiring, but he knew that if he did something extra, he would get a commission. That is known as, it is mentioned in the book, it is a stripe. Stripe is a kind of a badge. We can say like this kind of, you know, like it is a dwindling kind of a badge. Something written here, pinned up in the books. So that is called that badge, that stripe. He was desperately working for that. Everybody was. If there were 100 other privates, they all were. But his efforts were some extraordinary. He would deliberately stand up before his seniors. Yeah? Like everybody is sitting, some seniors walk by. Protocol is important in army. Please remember, it is very, very important. But before that, others could even react. He would jump out of his seat. He would just go and stand in an attention to show that he was all there ready for his duty. This was nothing but to pull his pyramids down. Slowly but steadily, people started understanding that his intention was not to show that he was great. He was trying to pull others down and then trying to raise up. Anytime, anywhere, the privates discussing about some personal affairs, some professional things, some academic things, anything, he would be there and start interrupting and correcting them. This was the most irritating factor with this boy, with this man. Was one of the very, very irritating factor. What was that? That he kept on correcting his fellow mates. Elders do correct the juniors. Elderly people, they will keep on correcting their younger ones. That is okay. That we adjust. Even if we are a little annoyed, we will not show it up. But if somebody of your age group, your category, your cadre, if somebody starts doing this, definitely nobody will like. Same happened with other privates. So what happened? The private, other privates started avoiding. They all started avoiding him. Nobody wanted to be with his close proximity. Okay. The things were going like that. He belittled his fellow folks. They were just trying to adjust and just clenching their teeth. Somehow they kept on adjusting with him. He belittled his fellow privates. Now, one day something surprising, astounding happened. What was that? That changed the life of the private. Let's see what had happened. One day, one very important session was going on. Though people avoided him, though they started just not to look at him, even then that did not deter his energy, enthusiasm. It is appreciable. Somebody, you know, was determined to get the stripe and doing lot of with energy and enthusiasm, that was really appreciable. But always remember that how much is required, that also we have to know. This common sense is very important. Now one day what happened? There was a training session again going on, and who was taking the training? That was Corporal Turnbull, a very, very strong and sturdy man. said about that, Corporal Turnbull was a very young man, young corporal, who was this given here. Let's mention this. Corporal Turnbull was so tough that you could hammer nails into him without his noticing it. This was the saying in the army camp. He was a man of not only strong, sturdy and stern, he was a man of no nonsense, honestly speaking. That actually means he knew his duty and he was young. He had come back from Dunkirk with his equipment correct and accounted for his kitten in his pocket. Again, it is an idiom, a kitten in his pocket. He had lot many things in his store, did his experience. In short, his kitten in his pocket means he had lot of experience to share with others and that he was ready to deliver. But no nonsense. This was his attitude. Right? So he was taking a session, a training session by. So naturally all the cadets were, all the privates were sitting there, sprawling and all, just attentively listening to his lecture, because already it was told to them that this man, be careful, like that. So everything was just, he was telling them about the hand grenades. Do you know what about the hand grenades? Again, it's like of a weapon. Hand grenades, something look like bomb sort. Like this, it has got some covering. Like that. And it has got a mouth here. You have to open it, tear it out from with your mouth and then throwing it to the enemy. This is the basic way of working with a hand grenade. Anyway, and you have to hold it with the grenade. Grenades are sometimes installed in the land also. But here's the hand grenade. He was telling them about the hand grenade. Now he was saying that while explaining, he was saying that outside of the grenade is divided up into a large number of fragments to assist segmentation. Technical thing, some segments were there. That is how you keep on channelizing it. While he had just completed this sentence, suddenly a voice came. 44. Corporal turned back and he said, who's that? What's that? 44 segments, the professor with beaming expression stood up and said. Okay, the corporal said. His face got tightened. Okay. Now he was about to give the next point. Then he came. And by the way, corporal, everybody's spine, there was a spine chill in the spine of others. This was the tone of the professor, Private Quelch. By the way, corporal, shouldn't you have started off with the five characteristics of the grenade? Our instructor at the other camp always used to, you know. This was actually told by the professor to whom? This man, about whom the whole unit knew that he was a man of no nonsense. He did not take any nonsense out going on there. And he had the guts to stand up to and interrupt and stop Corporal Turnbull, saying that you were wrong, sir. You should have started like this. So Corporal Turnbull stood up very steadily. And he said, do one thing. He just threw the grenade at this man, private. You give the lecture today. Professor was very happy. He thought he got, automatically he was given a position. You know, he was just beaming with his expression, heightened, and just he jumped up. Now, interruptive. Now, this when he interrupted, so what did he do? Corporal asked him to deliver the lecture. The beaming professor. The beaming professor, as usual, he was all heightened and he was beaming with his expression and all. enthusiasm, beaming with enthusiasm and glory. He thought he had already covered the whole distance. What he was striving for, you know, he was looking for that strike that is extra. We can call it as the best private sort of thing. So beaming with enthusiasm, he just got up and started giving the lecture. Of course, it was flawless, because we know professor was really very intelligent. There is no doubt in that. So he knew about the grenade and what all specific things were required to be told about grenade. He all delivered. After all, everything was given. Everything was done in a very, very proper manner. They were also sitting there, and Corporal Turnbull was, of course, sitting there somewhere out. Not out, I mean, he was sitting somewhere at the back. He was just watching. Okay? Now, after that, Corporal got up. When the lecture got over, he got up. And what did he do? He came close. He said, "Thank you so much, Private Quelch. You may please have your seat." So, as usual, with a lot of energy and enthusiasm, he just went and sat there. So others also looked at him, and they could not even turn their face because they were so scared. Of course, you ought to be scared of this fact. Now, all the other privates thought, now it was a time of dispersal. They say, disperse. So they, just before the dispersal, something happened. Now, this is what we need to know exactly from the book. Let's see. Yes. "As some of you may have heard," he began deliberately, before dispersal, okay? "As some of you may have heard," he began, "the platoon officer has asked me to nominate one of you for," and he took a pause. Of course, it was very normal to know that, of course, the platoon officer has asked somebody to nominate, Corporal Turnbull to nominate somebody who will be getting the stripe. Naturally, we all know, you do it in the class also, and the prize goes to, it is always that your heads also turn towards a deserving candidate. So all the heads turn towards Private Quelch, okay? And everybody was very jealous also to an extent. He paused and looked lingeringly up. Lingeringly means just took a pause and just observed everyone's faces, okay? Nicely. And down the ranks as if seeking final confirmation of the decision. So this was a great moment. Most of us could not help glancing at Private Quelch, of course, who stood rigidly to attention and stared straight in front of him with an expression of self-conscious innocence. Excellent language delivery this is, that he stood up because he knew. He was also very sure that he was only deserving candidate there. So he stood up very straight and about to take that order, and suddenly, then the corporal's voice came. "For the permanent cookhouse duties, I have decided that Private Quelch is just the man for the job." And he stopped. Could you understand what happened? The man, the private who was expecting to get a commission of a stripe, that is the highest rank of the privates, or you can say as a cadets, who everybody, best student award goes to, like in the school, and similarly in the army life. So he was about to, and he was confident of that. Now what happened? Corporal Turnbull simply stood up. And stood up to say what? He got up for an, got up, and there was an announcement. What was that announcement? That the permanent cookhouse duty. Cookhouse duty, you understand? The cookhouse duty means there's a unit in the army who prepares lunch and dinner for the army personnel. Army personnel, that is what is known as cookhouse duty. So since he was so perfect, Corporal Turnbull said,